Welcome everybody to Paleo Talks, episode 13. We have Dr. Greg McDonald with us. Many of us know Greg as the sort of world sloth expert, and then people often laugh and say, how many world sloth experts are there? And I'll let Greg answer that here in just a minute. We're gonna talk just a minute about the show. A little bit different today in that we're gonna keep on going with the recording. David, if you wanna give a brief overview of today and why we're on Facebook.
Sure thing. So yeah, we are mixing up our format. We've tried YouTube. We had a Zoom webinar in the past. This time we're trying out Facebook, which hopefully will give a bunch of people access that they didn't have before, the ability to comment, things like that. In the past, we've also kept the program a little shorter. Today, we're going to plan to keep it going a little bit longer. We will still do the same basic setup as the past. So we're going to start off by having our guest give their presentation. In this case, Greg talking about sloths. Blaine's going to ask him some questions and lead him through that. And then 20, 25 minutes, somewhere in there, we're going to open it up to questions from the audience. So if you are watching on Facebook, go ahead and when we open it up to questions, start typing your comments in the comment section and we'll start reading them off and we'll go for, maybe an hour, maybe till Greg gets tired. And if you're popping in partway through and it turns out you missed part of it, we're still recording. It'll still be up on YouTube afterwards so you can go back and watch it again.
That's right. Many people have questions about whether or not they're going to be able to see it later. Again, it will be available through our website. So Paleo Talks, that was David Moscato. He's our, what do we call you, David? Our science everything?
Science communicator. That's the kindest thing people call me.
Yes. Perfect. And I'm Blaine Schubert. I'm the director of the Center of Excellence in Paleontology. We're coming to you from Johnson City, Tennessee. We oversee the Gray Fossil Site and also a lot of other Pleistocene research as well. And we work with Greg McDonald a lot. And over the years, I've known Greg at least since 2004. I think that's what I can track it back to. But always, you know, somewhat so wonderful to talk to, and so many great ideas come from talking with Greg. And so it's my pleasure to introduce Greg, and he can introduce himself a little bit more and then start telling us about ground sloths. So if you want to share your first slide, Greg. So one of the things about ground sloths to me is that when I find something unusual from a fossil site that I cannot identify, it seems that oftentimes the direction ends up being, well, maybe it's a sloth. And more often than not, it seems to be true that that unusual thing that we're finding does end up being a sloth. And the Gray Fossil Site has a little sloth material. And Greg's looked at that too. And so I don't think there are many sloth specimens out there that Greg hasn't had a look at one time or another.
Is my first slide showing?
It is. If you want to go to the share, the whole presentation up in the very top, if you want, right up there in the very top, you'll see that little screen projector with an arrow on it. A little bit up higher.
Up higher.
On the orange right there. Just click on
that. There we go.
There we go.
Now we've just turned them into giant ground sloths. All right, we all set?
We're all set. Go, Greg.
All right, well, good morning to everyone out there. I understand we have some viewers from Brazil, so bom dia. And if we have any in other Latin American countries, buenos dias or buenos tardes, depending on what time zone you're in. And it's fun to be here, and hopefully I will not take as long as the Pleistocene ran in order to share a little bit of information about these critters here. So just to provide a little context, sloths are in the order Xenarthra, which means strange joint. And even though I live in Colorado, that does not refer to what these animals were smoking. It actually refers to an anatomical feature in their vertebrae where they have extra articulations in the lumbar vertebrae. And living ones today, of course, include the armadillos, the anteaters, and the living tree sloths. But when we get into the fossil record, they're a lot more diverse because we have the glyptodonts, really large armadillos or pamphotheres, and then of course the ground sloths, which are what I'm going to be talking about today. And we're very fortunate that we still have sloths around. We've got the three-toed sloth, of which there's four species, and the two-toed sloth, of which there's two species. But when we look even at this is a really small subset of all of the types of sloths when we get into the fossil record. And when we're talking about fossil sloths, there's basically four major groups that we think of. There's the megatheres, which are the ones that get most of the attention because they get the size of elephants in some of the late Pleistocene forms. So they're really big. We have the notrotheres, which are among the smaller ones that were around in the Pleistocene. The mylodont sloths, and then the megalonychid sloths. So these are the four major groups that we find amongst the types of fossil sloths.
Greg, can I add a question in there real quick?
Sure.
So when we look at the two modern species, we sort of think initially they look very similar. Are they closely related? How do they relate to the extinct forms? I seem to remember learning that they were two very different groups.
Yeah, actually, given the fact that both of the living genera, Coelepus the two-toed and Bradypus the three-toed, are totally arboreal. They live up in the trees, very rarely come down, except once a week to go to the bathroom, it's a phenomenal example of convergent evolution, and that they are not phylogenetically close. There's some discussion going on. Traditionally, the two-toed sloth Coelepus is put in with the megalonychid sloths down there in the lower right-hand corner. But some recent genetic work has suggested that maybe the two-toed sloth is more closely related to the mylodonts in the left. So this is one of the new things that's coming out of ancient DNA and the genetics. Every time we work with Bradypus, it doesn't fit in with any of the fossil ones. It's an oddball that sits out as an outgroup, and we're still trying to sort out where it goes. And of course, the challenge with both of them is there is no fossil record for either of the tree sloths. So one of the holy grails for sloth research would be start finding the fossils of either of the living genera, which we do not have at the moment.
Okay.
So if we talk about the discovery, early discovery of the sloths, of course, with the exploration of the New World, the modern sloths became known. And then it wasn't really till the late 1700s that a fossil skeleton, as depicted in the lower left-hand corner there, was found in northern Argentina, in Buenos Aires province. And it was collected and sent back to Spain. And it actually, if you have a chance to go to Madrid, it's in the National Museum of Natural History. And it has the distinction that while it was being worked on by the Spanish, and it was actually Cuvier, the French paleontologist, who actually got a hold of some drawings and sort of published before the Spaniards did, without ever seeing the original material. Cuvier proposed the name Megatherium Americanum, or the Great Beast of the Americas, but because he had such a great knowledge of comparative anatomy, he recognized that this huge animal was a sloth. And I might mention historically that this Megatherium skeleton that you're seeing on the screen was the first fossil skeleton ever to be mounted in a museum as a three-dimensional mount. And it was also the first fossil vertebrate to be given a Linnaean binomial name. So it has a lot of first and first fossil sloth, first Linnaean name, and first mounted skeleton. And one of the features that Cuvier recognized that allowed him to take the skull of this animal and say it was similar to the modern tree sloth is this really interesting flange that sticks down below the eye here. And you can see that on a two-toed sloth, there's the flange, and there's where the eye would be. And this is one of the really distinctive characters we see on sloth skulls that all sloths have, is this distinctive flange. But there's a lot of other neat things too. If we look at their teeth, there's no enamel. It's all dentine, so there's no hard enamel. They don't get any milk teeth or deciduous teeth, so they get one tooth that comes in and grows throughout the life of the animal. And you can see how these teeth here interlock for chopping up the twigs. And as the animal is chewing, they're actually self-sharpening the crests on the teeth. And we've actually got specimens from tar pits where when they were being prepared, we could find little twigs in the mouth. And if you look at all the lengths of the pieces, they're all about the same length, which is about the same distance between those two cutting surfaces there. So it's kind of neat that you've got this self-sharpening, ever-growing set of teeth, which apparently is one way of compensating for not having that hard enamel on the outside of the teeth. Now, of course, as I mentioned earlier, as soon as you start talking about sloths, everybody uses the term giant. These are giant ground sloths. And of course, when we get into the late Pleistocene, we have a couple of them that are the size of elephants. So obviously there were really, really big trees back then. No, we call them ground sloths for a reason. And of course, the one that I first mentioned, Megatherium, which is found only in South America. And it's generally found in Southern South America in the temperate regions, but it does get up into high elevations in the Andes, which is kind of interesting, with different species. And then actually bigger than Megatherium is Eremotherium, which we find in South, Central, and North America, but it's confined to more tropical and subtropical habitats. So here we've got two really big elephant-sized sloths, and they're living in two in very, very different types of habitats. If we talk about, say, Eremotherium larillardi, it's been coined as the Pan-American sloth. It has the widest latitudinal distribution of any known sloth. And so you get it from all the way from southern Brazil through the tropics, a little bit getting onto the West Coast, up through Central America, and it makes it into North America, into the United States, but it's confined to the Atlantic and Gulf coastal plains here. And once again, you can think of this as sort of the semi-tropical habitat, except for one record that we have from New Jersey. And I don't know if it was up there for the casinos or on vacation, but we guess it was probably up there during an interglacial, so when it was a little bit warmer. And then what we see is that as we start getting cooling and glacial advances in North America, the range decreases, and then it shrinks back into Central America, and our youngest ages for this animal at the end of the Pleistocene tend to be in Central and South America.
So Greg, when I think of North America in the late Pleistocene, I think of four sloth species up in the contiguous United States. But if we look a lot, you know, wider in terms of distribution, how many types of sloths do you think there were during the Pleistocene?
During the Pleistocene, I would say, I go by genera.
Okay.
It's rarely hard to go with species. A lot in the early days of describing, there were a lot of species name created that we've now synonymized and stuff like that. But if you look at, say, the late Pleistocene in North Central South America and the Caribbean, we're probably looking at between 20 and 30 genera. And what's interesting is, despite the fact that we've been working with these animals and finding them since the late 1700s, we're still making new discoveries. So we're not anywhere, I think, have where we've peaked out yet or plateaued in terms of new discoveries of sloths. And those discoveries are not just skeletons. I mean, we, you know, when we're talking about looking at the fossil record, what I'm interested in is the paleoecology, the natural history of these animals, why they were so successful as an herbivore, given their rather strange anatomy. And that means looking at other things as well. And of course, when you're talking about the evolutionary history of sloths, most of it's in South America. This is where they first appear, where the xenarthrins evolved, diversified. And so when we talk about the North American record, we're just sort of getting some overflow. And so if we go to South America and we focus here in this part of Argentina named near Bahia Blanca. And for those of you who pay attention to a guy by the name of Chuck Darwin, Bahia Blanca is one of the places that he stopped and went out and collected fossils on his trip, the 6 years he was out on the Beagle and that. Unfortunately, while he got to Bahia Blanca and collected fossils, he did not get to this area near Puenco on the coast here. And this is a really, really phenomenal site. And what's interesting is we're talking Pleistocene. Here's the coastline during the Pleistocene. Here's the site today. And so basically it was an inland site at the time that it was being formed. And what it, that makes the site so exciting is all these phenomenal tracks that they find. And basically these are within the tide zone. So during high tide, these tracks are covered up. They get buried with sand and you have to wait till the tide goes out and then you go brush the sand away. And this is a track or footprint of a megatherium. So this'll, if you give here, have this for a scale, it really gives you a good idea of just how big these animals were in terms of their right foot. Here's an impression of a claw, and here's where the heel would be. And as you can see, as it was stepping down, it was pushing mud away. And here we have an actual trackway of a megatherium. And they also get other sloth tracks. They have glyptodont. They have all kinds of the southern notoungulates. There's birds. It's an absolutely phenomenal track site. And this is a protected area, protected by Buenos Aires province.
One of the things that the track records is their unusual way of walking on the sides of their feet.
You talk about absolutely, yeah. Megatherium, Arimatherium, the Mylodonts, the Nothotheres, instead of being flat-footed, their foot is rotated so that they're walking. So what you're seeing here is actually the skin of that would be for the heel bone, the calcaneum, and the fifth metatarsal. So there is a really another strange aspect of sloth anatomy is that some of the sloths rotated their hind foot so that they're actually standing on the side of their foot. Not all sloths did this, but it seems to have evolved independently in at least three of those different groups of sloths that I showed earlier. Well, we could spend all day just talking about the megatheres, but very soon after Cuvier described megatherium from Argentina, there were some bones discovered in a cave in what's now West Virginia by saltpeter miners. And they sent him to this guy. Now, most of you may have heard of this guy. His name's Thomas Jefferson. He did a few things. He liked to write, you know, Declaration of Independence, things like that. But of course, what's really important for everybody to know is that he described the first sloth remains found in North America because of his interest in history, the bones were sent to him and he collaborated with Caspar Wistar. And Jefferson gets a lot of the credit, but Wistar was an early American doctor trained in anatomy. And besides Jefferson's paper presenting the megalonyx and creating the name megalonyx or great claw in reference to this large claw on the front foot, Wistar did the anatomical descriptions of the bone. So there's two papers that came out, and in 1799, Jefferson first presented an oral paper in 1797, but it wasn't published till 1799. And for those of us who do research, we know what exactly what it's like on how long it takes to get something in print. And that's been an American tradition since the 1700s. And here's a skull and jaw of Megalonyx that was found later. Megalonyx, the great claw, but what distinguishes this group, and it becomes the name for the family Megalonychidae, whereas Megatherium gave the name to the family Megatheridae, is that this large, enlarged tooth, it's not a true canine, we call it caniniform. As you can see, sloths don't really have true canines, they've lost those, they've lost the incisors, and they've reduced the dentition to 5 teeth above and 4 down below. And unfortunately, this particular skull is missing the zygomatic arch, so you can't see the nice bony flange. And here's just a picture of a mounted skeleton of Megalonyx. And you can see the flange there and the large tusk-like in front. And very long forelimbs, fairly massive hind limbs, really large pelvis. Their center of gravity is shifted towards the back there and probably helped them when they're sitting upright. A lot of times you'll see these animals depicted sitting upright, using their claws to grab branches of trees. And the Megalonyx was a browser just like the Megatheres were. So we see that these guys are predominantly plant eaters, but they diversify from being browsers and grazers. And Megalonyx is one of the most common of the ground sloths that we find here in North America. This distribution map sort of gives you an idea of its range. And I mentioned earlier that probably Aremotherium got as far north as New Jersey during an interglacial, but Megalonyx not out to be outdone. Actually, during the last interglacial, the Sangamonian got up into Alaska and into the Yukon. So, and then when it got cold and the glacier started advancing again, we have a record here in the early Wisconsin outside of Edmonton, and we lost that northern range and it sort of got compressed. But if you look at Megalonyx, it's in the temperate zone. We've got one record from down in Mexico from Pueblo, but Megalonyx seems to be adapted for more northern latitudes. But what's really been exciting in recent years is work in caves and cenotes in the Yucatan here, and diving there with cave divers has uncovered sloths. And that includes a new one that is a megalonychid. It's a relative of Megalonyx that we call Nohochichuk Shabalba Aka. And that is Mayan. And when we were trying to come up with a name for it, we kind of wanted to recognize geographically where this new sloth came from. And like I said, Megalonyx means great claw that Thomas Jefferson coined. And so I figured, well, we would just follow Thomas Jefferson, and Nohochichuk means great claw in Mayan. So it was an easy way to come up with that. Xibalba is the Mayan underworld where the caves are, and Aka means dweller. So this is, in Mayan, it's the great claw that dwells in the underworld. And besides Nohochichuk, we have Xibalba onyx, another megalonychid sloth that's been found down there. So we are now starting to understand the radiation of megalonychid sloths in the tropics here in southern Mexico and into Central America. So this is a part of these new exciting discoveries I was telling you about, Blaine, that we've always been biased by sort of the more temperate zones. We're now doing work in the tropics and learning there's a whole lot more about what happened when sloths left South America and moved up into Central America and North America. And not only did the megalonychids do it here, but one of the really horrible parts about having to work with sloths is that we find them in the Caribbean. We've got relatives of megalonyx in Cuba, Hispaniola, Puerto Rico. We've got them from the Netherlands Antilles, and they've recently been found from Grenada. So, you know, it's a dirty job, but someone's got to do it. You not only have to go down to the Mexican, you know, Riviera in Yucatan and Quintana Roo, but you've got to go do field work in the Caribbean as well. And there's a really good diversification. There's a really neat radiation of these sloths in the Caribbean. We've got megalochnus, which means giant sloth in Greek. We've got acrotochnus, we've got neochnus, we've got paroctnus, and there's a number of different species. This is another one of those examples, Blaine, where lots of species names were created early on. We've now synonymized them and recognized there's four genera. And these are not such giant ground sloths. Megalochnus here that we've got represented was about the size of a North American black bear. And that's the largest one that we get. And then on the island of Curacao, the Netherlands Antilles, just off the coast of Venezuela, we also have Paleochnus, which is not known from the best material in the world. It's one that needs a lot more study if we can find more material. So we can see that when you look at the megalonychid sloths, they were good at dispersing. They got out of South America, through Central America, into North America, and into the Caribbean island.
Yes, David had a comment.
Oh, I was just going to say, if I can interject, this is now that we're about 25 minutes into this presentation, and Greg has shown us all this really incredible stuff about sloths, there's been some chatter in the chat, in the comments on Facebook. So now I think would be a good time for us to open it up to questions. So we're going to let Greg keep telling us about sloths, but for the audience out there, if you have questions, if there's things you wanted to ask, go ahead and start putting them in the comments. And as the presentation continues, Blaine and I will keep an eye on those and we'll start asking Greg some of these questions. So for example, we actually have one already. So this is from Gavin, who asks, do we have complete ontogenetic series? So for everybody out there, that means young to old, baby to adult, for megalonyx.
Yes, we do. We actually have some young animals. They've come from some cave sites in the eastern United States. And so we can do some work on looking at the growth and changes from the young ones right up to the adults. So yes, fossils of young animals are not always the best, but for megalonyx, we're fortunate that we've got a reasonable record.
Actually, Sharon Holte, who is tuned in today, did her master's in, with Greg involved too, in looking at some of the ontogenetic growth in megalonyx at ETSU.
Yeah, she was very fortunate. She worked on a cave site that had a large number of individuals of all the different growth stages. So she's probably spent more time studying the growth and the changes that went on than anybody else with regards to how megalonyx grew. If we move on to the mylodont sloths, the mylodontidae, this is a depiction of paramylodon, and these are basically the grazing sloths. And they're very short, they're very stout. Here's the hyoid apparatus. And based on that, you'll also have a member of this group called Glossotherium, or the tongue beast. And they're thought to have had very large tongues, and some people have interpreted them as maybe been prehensile, like a giraffe's tongue, for grabbing vegetation in that. And this is Paramylodon harlani, named after the early naturalist Richard Harlan, who first described the jaw of this animal from Big Bone Lick in Kentucky. And the reason it's called paramylodon is that here we have Mylodon darwini, named after Charles Darwin, because he collected the first specimen on the voyage of the Beagle. And so this is not the same genus, but it's near Mylodon, so as to show that they are related. Once again, you can see the big bony flanges, and this is where the masseter muscles would come back right there. So these had very, very powerful chewing muscles. And these are grazers. The teeth tend to be flat for crushing vegetation. They don't have the same cutting action we see in the megatheres or in the megalonychids. And probably one of the most fantastic places that one could visit with regards to Mylodon Darwini is Cueva de Mylodon down in Chile near Tierra del Fuego. It's a cave site, it's a dry site, and there you will get claws with the nail material preserved. We have the dung preserved, and analysis of the dung shows that they were eating grasses and sedges like you would expect from a grazer. So what the anatomy first told us was independently confirmed by having this cave site where we've actually got the dung of it preserved. And of course, along with the nails and the dung, there have been large pieces of the skin preserved with the hair in place. And if you get swallowed by a Mylodon and are looking out, you'd be able to see all these little white things. These are bone. It's embedded in the skin. These are osteoderms that are preserved. And you can see them here in cross section. And it's only in the Mylodont sloths where we really get a number of individuals that have this dermal armor. It has been reported for one of the megatheres or Haematherium, but generally it seems to be present in only a few of the Mylodont sloths where you get this bony armor and it forms a nice mosaic in the skin.
Greg, we did have one question about the Caribbean sloths, and the question was, are they likely to be derived from South American ancestors or from somewhere else?
I think they came from South American ancestors. Mm-hmm. What's really interesting is the earliest record of a Caribbean sloth is late Oligocene. So they dispersed very early, even before they got into North America there. And so it would have probably had to come from a South American ancestor.
So could they have actually entered North America through that route instead of coming up the land bridge first?
Probably not. There's a lot of argument on the plate tectonics of the Caribbean and where the islands were. And there's been the interpretation of a large landmass called Garlandia that connected a bunch of the Caribbean islands and would have provided a route coming up out of northern South America like Venezuela in that area.
So speaking of dispersal of sloths, we actually have a couple other questions on sloth dispersal. One from Teus, and I apologize if I'm pronouncing that incorrectly, is related to what you were just saying, is how did the sloths arrive in islands like the Caribbean? You were just talking about potential land connections, but my understanding is that there were also sloths that were perfectly capable swimmers.
Yes, we have found that in one group of sloths in the family Nothotheridae. This is a Nothothera up on the screen here. So there probably was overwater dispersal. In fact, even tree sloths today will swim. So when you have sloths that live in forests that are flooded seasonally, they actually get between trees by swimming. They've got a really large stomach that probably acts as a float bladder. They don't swim fast. So they don't dog paddle, they sloth paddle. But the fact that they have a certain amount of positive buoyancy because of their long, large stomach, which probably helps them. So it's also possible that you might have had rafting on vegetation. If you think of Venezuela, the Orinoco River, seasonal flooding, vegetation coming out. And some of these earlier sloths, of course, are smaller. They're not the size of megatheres. And so they could have also been rafted onto the Caribbean islands as well.
All right, and then we'll still do one more sloth dispersal question for now.
Sure.
Dick asks, why didn't sloths make it into the old world, Eurasia, during the Pleistocene?
Well, if you consider the fact that the primary contact between the old world and new world across the Bering land bridge in the Pleistocene, which formed when the glaciers were there, you had the continental glaciers as a barrier, and you also, when they melted, then the Bering land bridge comes up, you've got another water barrier to cross. The other thing is we think and have some evidence that extinct sloths, like the living sloths, had a very low metabolism, were very sensitive to cold. If you think about it, even though modern sloths live in the tropics, they've got long, thick hair to retain what heat they generate because of their low metabolism. So they probably didn't do well trying to get into the old world across the Bering land bridge, because they had basically been driven southward with the advance of the continental glaciers. It's a kind of the counterpart to the fact that we had woolly rhinos in Siberia, but they didn't make it into Alaska or the Yukon during the Pleistocene either. So there's some type of filters going on there. And that's something that needs to be studied more.
Very interesting.
If we continue on, and here's the skull of Nothotheriops, our North American ground sloth. You notice different from Megalonyx. It doesn't have the large caniniform. It's only got four teeth here. This is Rampart Cave, and it's in the Grand Canyon. And it's another example of where we get these dry caves and we get the dung of these animals preserved. Tells us a lot about their diet. And Nothotheriops was living in deserts. It was desert adapted. A lot of the vegetation we find there, over 70 species of plants have been identified, and their desert vegetation like creosote, three-ring saltbrush, ephedra, and other desert plants. So when we talk about sloths, they're in the tropics, they're in the deserts, they're in their open grasslands. They diversified to be able to exploit a lot of different habitats in South America, Central America, North America, and the Caribbean. And because we find them in dry caves, here's a beautiful complete skeleton. This is of a young animal. Getting back to the earlier question about ontogeny of Megalonyx, we also get juveniles of other ones. And if you were to look at this, the epiphyses are not fused. It's not fully grown. It's got pieces of the skin on it. It's got dried ligaments. And we also find, again, the claws with the nails preserved. Here's an x-ray. There's the bony core. It just shows you how much bigger those claws got that certainly would have been useful for defending themselves against predators, as well as given that curve, hooking branches of trees to bring it down for feeding. So if we go to South America, once again, this is where the real story of sloths is. I'm going to take you to the coast of Peru, right along here. And here we have the Pisco Formation along the coast here. And we're going to look at another Nothotheria related to Nothotheriops. And this is not quite the same type of going to the Caribbean to look for fossils, but it's nice. You've got all this sand here. There's the Pacific Ocean in the back. You've got these hills, which are granite outcrops, weathered rock. And these are all marine deposits that have been stacked up. And with the uplift of the Andes, these marine deposits have been pushed up above the current sea level. And from what we can tell from the geology, this is the way the coast of Peru's been going back to the Miocene. And because you've got the winds coming off the Pacific, it blows the sand away, and you just go out, and here you can find a nice whale skeleton waiting to be collected by the paleontologist. So, of course, this is really paleontology paradise, because you don't have all that green vegetation in the way to hide the outcrops. And there's been a lot of work done in the Pisco Formation. I would say it looks pretty typically marine. You get a variety of sharks. You get penguins, including beautiful complete skeletons preserved. You get seals, sea lions. You get a variety of smaller whales and porpoises. And it's just beautifully preserved material. And so you go, okay, why somebody who works with sloths, who's interested in terrestrial animals, wasting his time in a marine deposit? And that's because on top of all those marine animals, we have found skeletons of a sloth related to Nothotheriops, and they, like the marine animals, come out as complete skeletons. And our interpretation is, based on the anatomy and where we find them, that these are sloths that were adapted to living in the ocean. They probably started out when the tide was out, going out and feeding on vegetation. And because there's, as you saw, there's not a lot of vegetation on the land, you got to go into the ocean to get to it. And here we have a phenomenal evolutionary sequence from the oldest to the youngest, showing an increase in size where the spout's more like typical sloths, then it becomes spatulate, presumably for grabbing seagrasses in that. And here you can see an increase in not only the spout, but also what you have here on the premaxilla expanding for reaching down and being able, like tweezers, to grab the seagrasses or possibly using their claws to dig them up. And you can see, just like Nothotheriops, they don't have a caniniform in front. They've only got four cheek teeth. And of course, today, when we think about mammals that feed on seagrasses, we generally think of manatees and dugongs. And one of the things that's interesting is they get these real heavy bones, so they're not buoyant, but they can dive down to feed on the grasses. And if you look at our fossil sloths, here's the terrestrial ones, large marrow cavity. But if you look here, you can see in our aquatic sloth, the bone is getting thicker and thicker through evolutionary time to make them less positively buoyant, so they can basically go down and feed on seagrasses. And today there's a remnant population of seagrass a little bit south of Peru, you know, off the coast of Chile, but we actually find that same fossil seagrass in the same deposits with the sloth, showing that their food was there. So we're interpreting this as that basically these sloths were aquatic, or at least semi-aquatic, and could basically dive down into the seagrass beds and basically feed on the seagrass and evolve to be more adapted to an aquatic environment through time. So this just shows you that, you know, we think of sloths as sort of being slothful, and they're not. They adapted to a wide variety of habitats, including being able to get out to the sea, and we see evolutionary changes in their skeleton for swimming, as well as their changes in the skull.
Greg, as we look at that picture right there, if you could go back real quick, sorry. The one where you're showing the sloth underwater, correct?
Yes.
What are your thoughts on whether or not it would have hair all over the body, thick like that, as being an aquatic sloth?
That's a really good question. It's very possible that they had become naked, like manatees and that. One of the things you have to keep in mind is when you're in the water, you lose a lot of heat. If they have a low metabolism, they're going to want to retain their heat. And if you think about fur seals that have a thick fur, sloths don't develop a lot of fat deposits. So they don't have the brown fat and yellow fat to the same degree that you see in other mammals. So it's very possible that their hair would have been shorter and thicker and denser like a fur seal, or it's possible that maybe they evolved to develop fat deposits to provide that insulation. We haven't found any fossil fat deposits yet, but we don't have any of the fossil hair from this sloth either. So we could go either way on our interpretation of what it looked like.
Hey, Greg, while we're on that subject, I'm sorry, Blaine, did I cut you off?
No, Greg had one final slide that I cut him off on if he wants to.
Oh, go ahead. I just wanted to say, during this time of COVID-19 and what we're dealing with, that this should be your motto. And now we can turn it over for, I'll wave goodbye and we can turn it over for questions.
Thank you.
Excellent. Well, I'd like to follow up that discussion just then about sloth hair. So Matthias in our chat asked about the depictions of sloth as furry. So the sloths you have, the images you have in your presentation show sloths as being furry, but do you consider it likely that ones from maybe warmer areas may have been furless?
It's very possible. We only actually have hair preserved for the two I showed you, the Mylodon darwini and the Nothotheriops shastensis. So those are, you know, two different families, and they both have fur. So it's possible. Richard Farina published a paper a few years back where he proposed that maybe Megatherium, given its large body size, was retaining its body heat simply through thermal inertia, and it may not have had long hair. And so we could possibly visualize Megatherium americanum and possibly even Eremotherium as being more like elephants, where maybe they had scattered hair, but their large body size provided enough thermal inertia that it retained what little body heat they produced. So it would be neat to eventually find a cave within the range of Megatherium and maybe find some mummified skin that would answer that question.
Great. Greg, I have a question and thought. One of the things that I get most excited about with the Pleistocene is the combination of the Pleistocene animals with caves, and therefore the animals that are more closely associated with caves, I tend to be even more interested in. And I know you have an interest in this too with sloths. If you could talk just a minute about those that are associated with caves and why you think that might be.
Well,
before you answer that, Greg, actually, if I can just throw in that we have a question that is about that, and maybe you can gear your answer in this direction a little bit.
Sure.
From Sharon and Maggie, which asks, could the concentration of sites in the eastern U.S. with sloths be related to that prevalence of natural caves and karst environments?
Absolutely. There's probably two answers to address here. One is, if you think about cave temperatures, they remain fairly constant year-round, act as a thermal buffer, and a cave temperature approximates the mean average temperature outside. So you can imagine in cold weather, if you have a sloth going into a cave, it's going from a colder outside environment to at least a relatively warmer environment in the cave, which is going to save on having to use up energy to thermoregulate and maintain its body temperature. The flip side of that is, in the desert environments where we find Ophiotheriops, which is commonly found in caves, what if in the summertime it's so hot it needs to go into the cave to cool off to maintain its body temperature and then would only go out at night to feed? So I can see caves being very important part of a way to thermoregulate both ways in sloths. But the other thing is that like in Rampart Cave that I showed a picture of, where there's multiple skeletons, there are juvenile sloth bones along with adults in there. And then the cave down in Alabama that Sharon worked on that had the adults and the juveniles, it's very possible that, you know, sloths used caves as den sites for raising their young. We don't think of them as fast animals able to run away from predators. So maybe giving birth in a cave is a way of protecting your young until they're big enough to go out.
We have on the subject of sloth families. So you've talked a couple times in this presentation about young versus old sloths. We have a question from Mariana, who asks, do we have evidence of sexual dimorphism in sloths?
We do for some, but not for all, but it hasn't been studied. Part of the challenge of figuring out the sexual dimorphism is having large enough samples from a single population where you can really look at consistent differences. One of the first papers describing this was by Castor Cartelli, based on a large sample of Arimatherium from a site in Brazil that he was working on. And he pointed out differences in the skull structure that showed differences in the sagittal crest and that would suggest that you could tell the males from the females. I also did that with a large sample of Paramylodon from Rancho La Brea, which is one of the few sites where you get a really good large sample of that species. And you could also see differences in skull proportions in that. So we do see that in a couple of sloths, but it needs to be looked at in a lot more different genera to see how consistent it is. And of course, that raises the question is, if they're sexually dimorphic, does that mean you're dealing with herds of sloths where the males, like if you're looking at sea lions, where you've got big males that have to set up harems, or are you looking at single family groups, or do you have the situation in some sloths, as I suspect was the case like in modern sloths, the male comes around at the right time, he spends a little time with the female, he adds to the perpetuation of the species, he goes off, and the female is left with the job of raising the young. So there's a number of scenarios, and some of this may be related to the degree of sexual dimorphism, and it wouldn't surprise me that different sloths had different approaches.
All right. You've mentioned in terms of this family dynamics and living in caves, you mentioned in passing predation, protection from predators. And Mason, in our comments, has asked, what were the natural predators of giant ground sloths?
Well, first, let's start in South America, since that's where they evolved. And of course, we don't have any placental predators at the time. So when sloths first appear, you're really dealing with carnivorous marsupials. You're dealing with the phororhachid birds, and you're dealing with a wide variety of crocodilians. So if you think about their evolutionary history in South America, they're basically dealing with a very different set of potential predators. And when you get into the Caribbean, basically the only predators we can find are very large birds. There's a relative of the barn owl, Ornimegalonyx, which apparently interpretation stood maybe 4 or 5, possibly 6 feet tall. So there were large predatory birds in the Caribbean that may have been going after the sloths. And so it's not till you get the exchange between North and South America that you get what we normally think of as sloth predators, the North American placentals, saber-toothed cats, short-faced bears, dire wolves. And of course, that's when with the Great American Biotic Interchange, you start getting saber-toothed cats, short-faced bears, canids coming into South America. So suddenly those South American sloths are introduced to a whole new set of potential predators that they had no evolutionary experience with.
Now, when we talk about natural predators, I think that the idea that, you know, people get in their heads with, especially big animals like a sloth who is huge in size and has the big claws, and they even have, you know, bony bits of armor in their skin. But a lot of that predation pressure would really be on the young ones, little sloths. Do you think that, do you think a full grown ground sloth would pretty much be safe from any predator that would want to mess with it?
Well, certainly when you get to the size of Megatherium and Rheumatherium, yes. But when you're dealing with Nothotheriops, it's smaller. So even a full grown adult is still vulnerable. Certainly with the larger sloths, I use the elephant scenario. If you think of baby elephants as being very susceptible to predators, but once they reach a certain size, they're too much trouble to deal with. I think that works for the sloths as well. In that the small ones, probably based on a site that I've been working on in Iowa with Holm Semkin and the folks at the University of Iowa, where they got an adult, a middle-sized sloth, and a newborn sloth living together. And the middle-sized one looks like it was just about half the size of the adult and probably reached the size where it was too big for predators and was probably just about ready to leave mom just as this new one was born and was going to be taken care of. So based on that Megalonyx from family group from Iowa, we're seeing that you probably had long-term care by the female until their young was large enough to be on its own. And about the time that she gave birth, probably after about 22 months, that one would go off and then she would take care of the newborn. So there's some really interesting dynamics going on there. But then, of course, this doesn't get into the potential that maybe some sloths lived in extended family groups or herds where you had multiple individuals that could take care of the young as well. So once again, there is no generic sloth. I think there were lots of different ways in which they had adapted to different environments and different types of predators.
All right. We got a couple of questions here about specific sloth genera. So these will be a little bit more specific, slightly more technical. Melissa asked, did Thalassocnus get split into two genera? And if so, when did that happen?
It has not been formally proposed yet. This has been an area of discussion with regards to myself, my colleagues, Christian de Mouzon, who I worked on Thalassocnus with. He was doing the field work and research down in Peru and interested in marine mammals and then got sucked into sloths by accident because they were mixed in with the marine mammals he was interested in. And we do see that by the time you get to the evolutionary lineage, they are quite different from the earlier ones. And so we had thought about the potential of naming it a different genus to show how much it had evolved from the ants' earlier forms in that. We had some disagreements with some cladists with regards to the fact that they all are all lumped together and they're just one after another, and that you really couldn't, under cladistic methodology, justify it. So it comes down to your taxonomic philosophy and at what point you can define it. It's a single evolutionary lineage, so some people prefer keeping it as a single genus, and some of us have thought that there's enough morphological differences that you could actually recognize two different evolutionary stages and use a different name to distinguish the more derived form from the earlier form.
Gotcha. And then another question comes from Grant, one of the former students of our program here at ETSU. Aratochnus sure looks similar to modern sloths, says Grant. Has DNA been sampled from that genus?
We do not have near as much ancient DNA from sloths as we would like. There was a paper that just came out a few months ago that reviewed all the samples, and this is the paper that, based on the preliminary results that we got and the short sequences we got, suggested that Megalonyx was closer to the Mylodonts, or that Coelepus was closer to the Mylodonts than to the Megalonychids, where it's traditionally put. And unfortunately, getting DNA out of the Caribbean sloths, the conditions have not really been conducive to the preservation. One of the things that we do like about the cave sites and the stable environments is that they increase the chances of getting DNA. But I have sent a lot of specimens to Hendrik Poynar, and so far we not have a good batting record in terms of getting it. So this is another one of those holy grails of sloth studies, is finding those really well-preserved specimens. We can get some ancient DNA and continue to refine our understanding. Right now, most of our phylogenetics coming out is based on morphology, with just a little smidge of DNA on top as a frosting.
Greg, Joanne asks about caves being dug by sloths in South America. You comment on that?
Well, there are sites in Argentina that Sergio Viscano and Susana Bargo have described, where they have found large burrows. I'm not sure I call them caves, but very large burrows that were dug out. And there's markings on the side that look like the claw marks that match up with claw marks made by sloths. And this gets back to maybe some of the sloths did dig out burrows as a place to get out of the sun or out of the heat, or to go when it was colder and that. So there are those in Argentina that I think are pretty well defended as being related to sloths. And they have found skeletons of some that had caved in. There's also some tunnels and cave systems in Brazil that have been described as also being related to sloths. The sedimentology is different. I've not had a chance to visit them to see them firsthand. I would say I'm a little bit more skeptical about the Brazilian ones, but if anybody would like to pay my way to go down there to examine them firsthand so I could give a more definite answer, please contact me. I'd be very happy to talk to you about this after the COVID-19 has run its course.
Right.
All right, we have a few more questions that have come in. We're approaching the hour mark on this talk, which is usually about the time that we start wrapping things up. So let's see, maybe we can do a lightning round through the last few of these questions, Greg.
I'll try and keep my answer here.
There are a couple that have been sitting here for a little while, so I'm going to go through these. Robert asks, have any sloth fossils been found in Southwest Georgia?
Yes, there are. Southwest Georgia. No, all the records I can think of in Georgia are from along the coast.
Okay.
But if there's caves in Southwest Georgia, it's worth checking out.
Of course. Matthias asks, is there paleontological evidence suggesting that sloths did indeed consume large fruits?
Once again, we're limited on our fossil record. We have the Mylodon dung, and we have Nothotheriops dung, and neither of those contain any seeds that would suggest large fruit. So there's not any direct evidence right now that they were seed dispersers. But once again, when you think about that, that's mostly in the tropics, Central America, with the work that Jansen did with neotropical anachronisms. And so what we're going to need to do is find some dry caves in Central America or Northern South America that might preserve dung, where we could actually look for tropical fruits and their seeds that might show up in their dung. But right now, there's no direct evidence.
Okay, and we got a question, question that came in via Twitter from Alton Dooley over in California, who asks, can you comment on the apparent co-occurrence of megalonyx and mastodons?
They show up together fairly commonly, especially in the eastern United States, and I think that reflects the fact that they're both forest animals, if you think, and they're both browsers. So, the co-occurrence is pretty common. I actually think I did a calculation somewhere of known sites for both of them, and that there's actually more mastodon records than megalonyx records, but they do overlap greatly in their range and have been found together in peat bogs in the eastern United States. And I think that reflects the fact that they were using the same type of forest habitat, probably eating different foods, but certainly a shared habitat.
Greg, I have one about extinctions in North America versus South America and what we know for sort of latest dates of species. What can you tell us?
We've got a better radiocarbon chronology for North America, especially for Nothotheriops. A lot of its dung's been dated. It's interesting, most of our radiocarbon dates for Nothotheriops is from dung. There's very few directly from the bones, whereas all our other sloths are based on bone dates. Paramylodon's not been dated very much, and there's only one date for Arimatherium. So our chronology for North America is somewhat limited. But we certainly know from Nothotheriops that it was surviving right up to the terminal Pleistocene, and we're now getting enough dates for megalonyx. That seems to be the case. I think Arimatherium was out of North America, had reduced its range before the terminal Pleistocene in North America, but was still surviving in the tropics of Central and South America. We need to improve our chronology for South America as well in terms of doing it, in terms of getting enough samples over a wide enough geographic area to really know what's going on. And there's a lot of genera down there we don't have dates for. The best chronology for extinction is the Caribbean. And we now know that the Caribbean sloths were surviving up to between 4,000 and 5,000 years ago. So the last surviving ground sloths were in the Caribbean based on radiocarbon dates on specimens from Hispaniola and Cuba.
Were any of them very large?
In the Caribbean?
Right.
No. The largest one was Megalochnus, which was about black bear size.
All right, Greg, I've got one more question from our comments, and then I have a question that is my own question that I've been sitting on. The comments question is from Eric Scott, and I'm going to read this verbatim because that'll be important. Eric says, with respect to sloth caves in southern Brazil, is the current thinking that sloths dug the caves from scratch, pun intended, hi, Greg, or is it thought that the caves already existed in some form and the sloths expanded them by digging and scratching?
From what I understand, it's been suggested that they sloths went in and modified pre-existing caves in the soft sediments. So, and that's just based on my reading articles and what have been presented by the researchers who have actually spent time looking at the caves, that they were hollow spots secondarily modified by the sloths.
Okay. And then my question, just before we wrap everything up, one of the things that I think is so fascinating and can really throw us for a loop paleontologically is that we always want to compare fossil species to their closest relatives today. But a lot of our living animals are these weird, strange relics of these very diverse ancient groups. And the sloths are possibly the best example of this, where our modern sloths are nothing like what a lot of the diversity of ancient sloths are. What happened? What happened that you had all this apparently very successful diversity of sloths that has now been reduced to these comparatively very strange and very specific tree sloths that are left over today?
Well, you just put your finger on the whole purpose of what I do and a lot of other great sloth workers. I mean, I've been very fortunate that I'm not alone in terms of working on sloths. There's a lot of good people out there. I'm part of a network. We're all contributing. We're all working on our own interests. And certainly one of the reasons why I focus on the paleoecology and the natural history and the diet and the social group and all those things about the sloth, not only because it's intellectually challenging, but this is what's going to lead up to why did they go extinct? Why did they not make it, given how successful they were for millions of years? And so to me, to look at extinction without having an in-depth understanding of the ecology, natural history, and everything you can glean from the fossil record that's available that tells you about what these animals, when they did by their life, and when they're alive, trying to explain their extinction, you're just kind of spinning your wheels. And I think we see this in that it comes down with Pleistocene extinctions. Did humans do it? Did the environment do it? You know, we make it an either or, and I think it's a much more complex story than that. What keeps me and other paleontologists, you know, it doesn't matter whether it's sloths, whether it's mastodons, mammoths, the horses, all those other animals that went extinct in North America, South America, Eurasia, we really first have to think of ourselves as biologists trying to understand the natural history before we think about why they disappeared, so that we can put some constraints on our theories and not just sort of spinning just so stories.
Greg, I have one final question I meant to ask you in the very beginning, but it's just simply why sloths? And it goes back to, you did your master's degree on sloths, huge master's thesis, even more massive PhD dissertation on sloths. What was it, you know, that led you down that path as a paleontologist to do sloths at that time?
Pure fortuitous accident. When I was an undergraduate in Idaho, an amateur collector found a complete skeleton of a megalonyx at American Falls Reservoir. And John White, my professor, assigned me the job of preparing that specimen. And after I finished it, John, being the consummate professor, said, okay, Greg, now your job is to figure out what this animal is and write me up a little report. So it got me into the literature in that. And then when I was ready to go to graduate school, the other shoe dropped and John said, hey, Greg, you're going to Florida to work with Dave Webb. He's interested in sloths. You might want to do it on megalonyx. And you've got this beautiful undescribed specimen and this other material here in Idaho, and they've got it in the collections down there. So I quickly learned, looking at the literature, that there was really nobody else working on the group. Mm-hmm. So I was kind of like, well, here's an open niche I can move into. I'm very fortunate that I went from sort of feeling like the Maytag washer repairman, only working on sloths, that now there's a lot more interest. We get sloth get-togethers at meetings and exchange information, and it's a lot of fun. And hey, if you're going to study an animal, sloths are great. As John White put it, they never read Gray's Anatomy. Strange anatomy, strange ecology. Why not have something that's going to be really intellectually challenging?
Yeah, I think it's so interesting that you've sort of spawned this huge group now, almost, of people that you're the leader of, in many ways, of this sloth movement.
I wouldn't claim that. There's a lot of people.
I know you wouldn't, but we all go to you when it comes to sloth questions, and it's thank you for all you've done. And thanks so much for being on the show, Greg. It was a great
pleasure, and thank you for those of you who took the time to listen today. I appreciate your interest.
All right.
And thank you to everybody who joined us, like Greg just said. And as a reminder, if you joined us late, if you missed the start, we are going to post this up on YouTube, the video of the recording of this program, along with all the other Paleo Talks. And I believe we'll be back next week.
Yep, that's right. Where we will have Jack Singh, actually. So.
Oh, good.
Yeah. All right. Thank you again.
Thanks, Greg.
My pleasure. Thank you for inviting me.